The song they sang has some resemblance to the gospel reading we read this morning. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I don't want to go into the reliable message. Amen.
Amen.
Which is coming from the book of St. John, chapter 13, from verse 2 to 19. Let us put our hands together, Christian friends, to welcome Reverend Dr. Tiffany Lambert to our church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the sermon theme is, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Deacon Thomas. I want to seize this opportunity to wish everybody a happy Palm Sunday.
Amen.
May God bless us. May God make this the beginning of many good things to come in our life. I bow here for prayer, Almighty Father. We thank you, Lord, for this privilege we have in thee. We thank you, Father, for bringing us before your throne of grace this morning, once again to celebrate Hosanna in the highest. Who is the Son of Man that is coming in the name of the God. We thank you, Lord, for this day. We beseech thee, Father Almighty, to anoint your message. I know the tongue that will deliver it, Father, and please, Father, consecrate our hearts this morning.
Amen.
Let us receive this good news, this good tidings, O Lord, with good faith. Let your name be praised, O Lord, at the end of this message, Father. Never let our life be sneaking.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for this day in our life. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, Father, we pray.
Amen.
Can you please be seated? The sermon this morning is coming from the book of John, chapter 13, and I'll be reading from verses 1 to 20. The book of John, chapter 13, verses 1 to 20. This is the chapter that is leading us into the last days of our Lord Jesus Christ on this Mother Earth before he returned to his Father, the Last Supper. Now, before the feast of the Passover, Jesus, knowing that his hour had come, that he would depart out of this world to the Father, having loved his own who we are in the world, he loved them to the end. During supper, the devil, having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come forth from God and was going back to God, got up from supper and laid aside his garments, and taking a towel, he girded himself. Then he poured water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girded. So he came to Simon Peter. He said to him, "Lord, do you wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I do to you, you do not realize now, but you will understand hereafter." Peter said to him, "Never shall you wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me."
Amen.
Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, then wash not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." And Jesus said to them, "He who has bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you." For he knew the one who was betraying him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and taken his garments and reclined at the table again, he said to them, Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for so I am. If I then, the Lord and the teacher, wash your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I gave you an example, that you also should do as I did to you. Truly, truly, I say to you, a slave is not greater than his master, nor is one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. I do not speak of all of you. I know the ones I have chosen. But it is that the scriptures may be fulfilled. He who eats my bread has lifted up his head against me.
Amen.
For now on, I am telling you before it comes to pass, so that when it does occur, you may believe that I am he. Verse 20. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who receives whoever has sent receives me, and he who receives me receives him who sent me. May God bless his holy word.
Amen.
Our theme this morning, as our deaconess told us, is the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Once again, we'll be going back down the corridor of history, 400 years before Jesus Christ was born. Prophet Isaiah prophesied about the Messiah. He said he was despised and forsaken of men, a man of sorrow and acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely, our grief he himself bore, and our sorrow he carried. Yet we ourselves esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was pierced through for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities, and the chastisement for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging we are healed. Isaiah 53:3-5. Is anything new under the sun? As it was in the beginning, so it is, and so shall it ever be. Nothing is new again. All works have been completed in Christ. The good news will always be preached, and let those who have ears hear and be saved. And those who will forbear refuse to hear and follow the path that leads to destruction. What we find in the world today, it is a common practice that when any head of a country or an organization or political leaders or head of a financial empire or a church leader are being sworn in into an esteemed leadership position, among their oaths being recited goes something like this: I swear to serve my country or organization or church or ministry or establishment and the citizens of my people, and to the best of my ability to uphold their rights and privileges and protect the integrity and honor of my country, my church or organization. So help me God. So now, their hands are firmly in grip of that staff of authority and start tasting the honey of power, that they forget these promises and just lock up the swearing old document inside the steel cabinet till the time for re-election into that leadership position, or whenever the tenure of their leadership is challenged, before they realize that no electoral position is permanent. If you change the rule to create lifelong presidency when it is God's time, to find a leader that is ready to serve his people, then you will realize that no one is indispensable. The Bible is clear on this aspect of our Lord's teachings on servant leadership, which is best defined by Jesus himself in Matthew 20, 26-28, it reads, "Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." In the Christian realm, all leadership positions should follow the pattern of servant leadership.
Amen.
A common misconception among those who want to exercise a leadership role over others is that it comes with glory, it comes with power, and also with positions of honor. In fact, such a mistaken belief was the occasion for Jesus' words in the above passage. James and John had just asked Jesus to place them at his right side, where he assumed his throne in the kingdom to come.
Yes.
As we read in Mark 10, 35-45, and James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came unto him, saying, "Master, we will that thou should do for us whatever we shall desire." And he said unto them, "What will ye that I should do for you?" They said unto him, "Grant unto us that we may sit one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory." But Jesus said unto them, "You know not what you ask. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of?
Amen.
And be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" And they said unto him, "We can." And Jesus said unto them, "You shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of, and with the baptism that I am baptized with of shall you be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and on my left hand is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared." May God bless his holy word.
Amen.
And when the other disciples heard about their selfish desire, they became indignant at the arrogance of their request. Mark 10:41, when the Lord became aware of the unhealthy rivalry developing among his disciples as to who will be the leader after their master told them about his trial, as we also read in Luke 9:44-48. Listen carefully to what I am about to tell you. The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. But they did not understand what this meant. It was hidden from them so that they did not grasp it, and they were afraid to ask him about it. An argument started among the disciples as to which of them would be the greatest. Jesus, knowing their thoughts, took a little child and had him stand beside him. Then he said to them, "Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. For it is the one who is least among you or who is the greatest." When the Lord saw that his own disciples too had not yet understood the moral course of his ministry and still unable to embrace that virtue of humility, but rather thinking, like many of us today, the Lord had to model the true servant style of leadership, he, the Lord incarnate, bent down and washed their feet, teaching them the true meaning of leading by first serving others. Jesus washing the feet of the disciples, John 13:1-17, the court in the upper room, just prior to the Last Supper, and has significance in three ways. For Jesus, it was the display of his humility and his servanthood. For the disciple, the washing of their feet was in direct contrast to their hard attitudes at that time. For us, washing feet is symbolic of our role in the body of Christ, walking in sandals on the filthy roads of Palestine. In the first century, it made it imperative that feet be washed before a communal meal. especially since people reclined at a low table and their feet were very much in evidence. When Jesus rose from the table and began to wash the feet of the disciples, he was doing the work of the lowest of servants. The disciples must have been stunned at this act of humility and condescension that Christ, their Lord and Master, should wash the feet of the disciples when it was their proper work to wash his. But when Jesus came to earth, he came not as king and conqueror, but as the suffering servant, as foretold in Isaiah 53. His disciples Matthew also remarked of his master in Matthew 20:28, he came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The humility expressed by his act when he took towel and basin and bent down to start washing the feet of the disciples before the Last Supper, he who laughed with them on earth, foreshadowed his ultimate act of humility and love on the cross. How many of our leaders today, both in private and public sectors, have learned any lesson